that. In the last lecture, we talked about heat transfer inflow through a tube. Under the condition that we are far enough downstream from the cross-section at which the heating or cooling through the surface started, that the flow is laminar and steady. And maybe in this circle I should add that the walls are rigid, because of course, for instance, in flow of blood through blood vessels, we have a more complicated situation. First, that the flow is in many cases not steady, but fluctuates, and that as a consequence, the walls expand or contract also. But one has to first look at a simpler situation in order to later on add the complications which occur in this system. Then we found that we can describe, or it is conventional to describe the heat flux per unit area, per unit time, from the wall of the tube or through the wall of the tube into the liquid by a heat transfer coefficient, which in turn we characterize by a dimensionless property called the Nusselt number, and by a approximate calculation we got the answer that the Nusselt number has approximately the value 4. We found also that actually the Nusselt number varies depending on how we apply the heating, whether we apply a constant heat flux through the wall or whether we keep, for instance, the outside of the wall of the tube at a constant uniform temperature. This changes the Nusselt number by approximately plus minus 10%. Now, today we want to look into tube flow in the connection that we apply the tube, use the tube as a part of a heat exchanger in which we want to exchange heat from a hotter fluid to a cooler fluid. We could do this, for instance, in the following case, in the following situation, that we have again a tube with a flow of one fluid, which I will indicate by the index 1, through the tube, let's say, with a mass flow M1 dot, and we surround this tube by another tube of larger diameter, and make arrangements so that we can also duct fluid through the outer tube. Let's say at a mass flow M2 dot. And we will indicate the temperature of the fluid 1 at the entrance, so the temperature at which we would have available the fluid M1 T1 at the inlet. Let's call the temperature with which this fluid leaves the tube T1 at the exit. And in the same way, we will call the temperature of the second fluid at the inlet T2 inlet and at the exit T2 exit. Now, obviously, we want to heat a certain fluid, let's say the fluid 2, from the inlet temperature to some other temperature. So we will assume that we know the exit temperature of this fluid. Then if we draw a diagram, over the corresponding location in the heat exchanger, the temperatures, T, and this would, for instance, mark the inlet temperature of the fluid 2, T2 inlet. And we want to heat it to an outlet temperature, T2 exit. And the way in which the temperature of the fluid 2 changes in the heat exchanger might be this, given by this curve. And we would have a temperature T1 at the inlet prescribed. Then one thing which we can immediately very simply calculate what is the outlet temperature of the fluid P1I? Because, and if we assume that the heat loss to the surrounding is negligible, so that means all of the heat which is transferred from the fluid 1 through the wall of the heat exchanger is actually picked up by the fluid 2. Now, the heat which is needed in order to increase the temperature of fluid 2 from T2I to T2E would be the following: m dot, m2 dot, this is a mass flow rate per unit time, multiplied with the heat specific heat, gives the heat capacity. And this multiplied with the temperature increase gives the heat which is necessary to increase the temperature of the fluid from T2E to T2I. And if there are no heat losses, then the same heat must be given off by the fluid 1. So we can write this is equal to C1 times M1 dot times T1 inlet minus T1 exit. And in this way I could calculate the T1 exit. Let's say I would get by this calculation this temperature. This means the temperature variation of the fluid 1 in the heat exchanger would be something like this. But of course this doesn't work, because in the second part we want to transfer the heat from 1 to 2, we would have to move the heat from a colder fluid to a hotter fluid. This by itself is not possible, so this would be impossible. But we can actually still accomplish this with the heat exchanger if we just use one trick, if we reverse the flow of the fluid M2 or M1. If we do the following, we have now again the heat exchanger. And let's say we leave the fluid of M1 in the way as we had it before. And we reverse the direction of the flow of the fluid too. Let's again draw a picture of the temperatures as they would exist in this case. If we again start out with the fluid M2, then this enters now with the inlet temperature T2I, but on this side here. So we would have the T2I on this side, the fluid exit temperature T2E would be here. Now, the first fluid enters with a temperature T1I, which would be this one here. And it exits with a temperature T1E, which would be this one. And now, obviously, this is well possible. We don't know, and I will not go through the calculation, how one would actually calculate the temperature variation within the fluid. But obviously, this is possible. We call this a parallel flow arrangement, this a counterflow arrangement. And this counterflow arrangement is then obviously the more effective one, in the sense that we can get larger heating, larger temperature increases in the counterflow arrangement than in the parallel flow arrangement. Obviously, in the parallel flow arrangement, we could only go to a end temperature where the two curves approach each other but don't cross over. One additional question which obviously would remain in this connection is, if we have made this calculation, we would like to know what kind of, what size of heat exchanger do we have to use in order to actually get to these temperature conditions, either in the parallel flow. Well, let's go to the counterflow, because this is obviously a possible arrangement. For this purpose, we will look at a certain cross-section. Let's say this cross-section here. And I will sketch a part of the wall in more detail out. This would be now the wall with a certain thickness, which we called before B. The wall material has a certain thermal conductivity, which we called A. Now, we have the situation that we transfer heat from the hotter fluid, from the fluid flowing through the inner tube, to the tube wall. And this transfer we characterize by a heat transfer coefficient H1. We transfer heat then through the tube wall. And finally, we transfer then heat from the hotter fluid, from the other tube wall into the outer fluid. And again, transfer from a solid wall into a fluid we describe by a heat transfer coefficient H2. And now we can use the procedure which we actually have used in the first lecture. In steady state, the same amount of heat which is transferred to the tube wall must flow through the tube and must also be transferred to the outer fluid, because in steady state there is no possibility to store fluid. So we can write for the heat flux per unit area and per unit time through the tube wall, or first from the hot fluid into the tube wall, heat transfer coefficient H1 times a temperature difference. And we have seen before that for tube flow, we customarily use the difference between the mixed mean temperature in the fluid, or bulk temperature in the fluid, and the tube wall surface temperature. So if we call the bulk temperature TB1, the mixed mean temperature in the fluid 1 minus the wall temperature of the wall bordering the fluid 1. Actually, going back here and looking at these exit temperatures a little bit more careful, what we will have is that since we have a heat flux in the fluid, that the fluid will leave the heat exchanger not with a uniform temperature, uniform over the cross-section, but with a variable temperature over the cross-section. And this means this is here actually a mean temperature, and it is just this mixed mean or bulk temperature. So these exit temperatures which appear here are to be interpreted as bulk temperatures. In the same way, then, these temperatures here would be temperatures which we get if we would mix the fluid which passes through this cross-section thoroughly up, so that the temperature becomes uniform. Then the next part of the heat transfer is by conduction through the tube wall, and we know how to write this. Now, if the actually we would have to consider the heat conduction through a cylindrical shell. If the wall thickness is small compared to the radius of the tube, the equation will be the same as if this would be a plain wall. So we will assume that the tube wall thickness, as is often the case, is small, so that we can use the equation for heat flux by conduction through a plain wall. And then the heat flux is simply given by thermal conductivity divided by the thickness of the tube wall and multiplied with the temperature difference of the two wall surfaces, T wall 1 minus T wall 2. And finally, in the last step, the heat has to be transferred from the outer surface into the other fluid. And we write this again. The same heat flux is equal to a heat transfer coefficient on the outside minus, and now since the heat flux is directed from the tube wall, T wall 2 minus the bulk temperature in the outer fluid. Now, let's see, how would we find the heat transfer coefficients involved? For flow through a tube, we have seen that the Nusselt number is equal to 4. Checking back, what is the definition of the Nusselt number? The Nusselt number is defined as heat transfer coefficient times diameter of the tube divided by thermal conductivity. In this case now, it's heat transfer coefficient 1 of the fluid flowing through the tube to the thermal conductivity flowing through the tube. Then the tube diameter, of course, is the diameter of the tube through which the heat transfer occurs. So the heat transfer occurs. And this means this has a value, if we are satisfied to get an answer within about 10%, then we can use the upper relation and can calculate the heat transfer coefficient H1. Now, heat transfer coefficient H2 is connected with flow through this ring-shaped cross-section. And the question is, how do we calculate the heat transfer coefficient for this? If you recall how we determine the heat transfer coefficient through the inner tube, then we said that from measurements we know that the temperature profile is approximately parabolic in shape. And from this then we got this information. Now on the outer tube we expect a temperature profile which would look the following way. There's again heat transfer from the wall into the fluid, so there must be a temperature gradient in the fluid to take care of this. But we said there is no heat transfer through the outer tube. We neglected any kind of heat losses on the outside, so there can be no temperature gradient in the outer tube. So we would get essentially this shape. We would expect a shape like this. And this means really this in a sense is equivalent to half of the temperature profile in the outer tube. So if we call this dimension, let's say S, then we can expect that as an estimate, so we can get the heat transfer coefficient for this from this equation if we replace the diameter which we have here, or half the diameter, if we equate half the diameter to the distance S. So we would say the H2 times, let's say, we would write this here 2R, 2 times the radius, so 2S divided by K2 is again approximately equal to 4. Now I didn't check, but I would guess that this would again give an answer which between 10-20% is correct. So in this way then we have also the heat transfer coefficient H1. We know of course the thermal conductivity of the tube material, or we have to know it if we want to make a calculation. We know the thickness. Now, in order to simplify then the equation, we again do what we had done before. We solve the three equations for the temperature differences. We get PB1 minus TVol1 is equal to QVol, let me write it in this way, times 1 over H1. And the next equation, TVol1 minus TVol2 is equal QVol times B over K. And the last equation, TVol2 minus TBulk2 is equal to QVol times 1 over H2. And if I add then these three equations, then again the TVol1 temperature, this wall temperature drops out. What remains on one side of the equation is just the difference between the two bulk temperatures. QVol times 1 over H1 plus B over K plus 1 over H2. And now we will abbreviate this here, call this here the term in brackets 1 over capital U, and one calls this U the overall heat transfer coefficient, which then consists the film heat transfer coefficient on one side, on the term describing the conduction through the wall, and the heat transfer coefficient on the other side. And if we this finally solve this finally for Q wall, we have Q wall, which, since I write it as a lowercase term, is the heat flux through a unit area of the wall, is equal to the overall heat transfer coefficient times the difference between the two bulk temperatures. So this is convenient to use this term because then this equation looks exactly the same, has exactly the same shape as these equations, only that now the overall temperature difference is involved and therefore correspondingly the overall heat transfer coefficient. Now, we look up to now at this cross-section. So one are interested in the heat flux per unit area at this cross-section through the tube wall. Actually, this TB1 minus TB2 is here this temperature difference in this cross-section. We could abbreviate it simply as delta T. And then, if we now want to calculate the heat flux through the total heat exchanging wall in the heat exchanger, since this is per unit area, we have to multiply this with an area. So the total heat which is exchanged in the heat exchanger is equal to U times area. This would be surface area of the inner tube through which the heat flow occurs, times temperature difference. But now the question is which one? You see, in general, the temperature difference varies along the heat exchanger, especially here in this arrangement. So we will write this a mean, obviously, a mean temperature difference. And now, in order to determine this mean temperature difference, one would essentially have to first write this equation down for a small section of the heat exchanger and then integrate it over the whole heat exchanger. But I will not go through this. I will just write the equation down which gives the end result. And for this purpose, we will call the temperature difference at the inlet between the two fluids delta P at the inlet, and the temperature difference at the exit of the two fluids, delta T exit. And then this mean temperature difference is what one calls a logarithmic mean temperature difference, and is given by the equation delta T at the inlet minus delta T at the exit divided by the natural logarithm of the ratio delta T inlet over delta T outlet, exit. Now again, one can look the logarithm up in handbooks and then in this way calculate the delta Tm. A simpler mean is the following. Especially simple to calculate is a mean temperature difference, which we call the arithmetic mean, which I will indicate by a index capital M. And this would be half of the sum of these values. So delta P inlet plus delta P exit over 2. And then in order, so this is very simple to calculate. Now in order to calculate from this here to this value, we will write the equation that delta P, the actual one which I actually want to have, the log mean temperature difference, is B times delta T capital M. So I have to multiplies the arithmetic mean, which is simple to calculate, with a factor b in order to get the logarithmic mean, which I need. And I will give a table for the value b. If the ratio of the delta t inlet to the delta t exit has the following values, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 8, 10, then this factor b has the following values, 1, 0, 0.962, 0, 0.910, 0, 0.796, 0.798, 0.748, and this is a bit further, further value 10, 0.71. So since these values are not too far apart, one can actually, with the accuracy with which in which one is usually interested, quite easily interpolate, so that for each ratio of the temperature differences, I can get the corresponding value b, and then with the arithmetic mean calculate my actual temperature difference. Sometimes one finds that the value delta Ti over delta Te is smaller than 1. Then what one does is just to calculate the reverse ratio, delta Te over delta Ti, and this table holds just as well for the reverse ratio. In addition, this table holds for parallel flow just as well as for counter flow, so for whatever flow configuration I have. So in this way then one would have the answer for to the problem which we have posed to calculate if I, well, the heat flux Q of course is also equal to this, either of these equations. I know the Q, I can calculate from the flow situation the overall heat transfer coefficient with this equation. I calculate then my mean temperature difference from the inlet exit temperatures which I have calculated above, and then I can solve the equation for the surface area of the heat exchanger which is required. One just finds that if the temperature difference goes to zero, then one finds the mean temperature goes to zero, too, the area becomes infinity. Because this goes only asymptotically, you see. Okay. Yes. Hans? Let's say, in order to, for this flow situation, to get the T2E equal to T1E, to get the two temperatures, exit temperatures equal to each other, one would need an infinitely long heat exchanger. So the calculation would result in the in A equal infinity. Sure. Sure. Yes. Okay, yeah, this is correct. Let's say one would have to know the value for ratios larger than 10. Well, then one would have to go to this equation and look up the corresponding value in tables. Just one remark. The last time I mentioned that in, let's say, a quite effective counterflow heat exchanger occurs in certain animals, in that the temperature of the blood is much cooler in the, let's say, in the extremities, in the legs, for instance, than in the body itself. And this is done in the way that the blood flows down from the heart into the extremity, then here heat is lost to the surrounding, and then the blood flows back. So, and then this part is really a counterflow heat exchanger, the same as we have it here. The one stream flows down, the one stream flows up. In this specific situation, we would have the equation that the M1 dot would be equal to M2 dot. The same mass flows through both down here and flows up again. And one finds that in this situation, these temperature profiles in the throughout the heat exchanger are not curved anymore. They are just two straight lines. So this means that one temperature would decrease linearly down, the other temperature would increase linearly upward. With this, we want to close at the moment our discussion for flow through a tube. One thing which we have not yet established is, I mentioned always that the relation, which I just erased now, Nusselt equal 4, approximately equal 4, holds far enough downstream from the beginning of the heating of the tube wall. We would surely want to know how far downstream. But I will come back to this later on when we can answer this, when we see this clearer, how far, let's say, how one can establish this. Of course, in calculating here, for instance, these two heat transfer coefficients with the relation Nusselt approximately equal 4, we have assumed that the condition where the equation, the corresponding equation holds, is obtained comparatively close to the entrance, so that this length is long compared to the inlet length, to the thermally developing region. Now, we want to look at another very characteristic situation. Tube flow is a special situation of, let's say, flow of, through a duct of any arbitrary cross-section. I will not talk about this. One, if one would like to know, make calculations for other cross-sections, well, the essential thing is that one would have to know the heat transfer coefficients for such cross-sections. And values for these are available, or let's say relations for these are available in various textbooks and handbooks. But I would like to go now to a situation which we call external flow. If we have some kind of body and a flow around this body. Again, we assume that the flow is laminar steady. Then we have discussed that if the Reynolds number is large enough, that the situation is the following, that a boundary layer exists around the body, which is the thinner, the larger the Reynolds number, and that the viscosity of the fluid is important only in this region. If we have a heat transfer situation, this means if the body has a temperature T, 2, which is different from the temperature T, let's say 0, of the fluid. And again, the Reynolds number is sufficiently large, we find that the temperature field, which is caused by the heat flux from the surface of the heated body in the fluid, is again contained within a thin boundary layer, which we then call the thermal boundary layer. Now, actually, we can then apply this situation to any geometry, even if we have flow through a duct, if only the duct walls are far enough away from the body so that the dimension, the thickness of the boundary layer is small compared to the thickness of the duct. In this case, we would also really classify this as a boundary layer flow situation or external flow situation. Now, as a characteristic and simple geometry of this, we will assume that the body is very slender, so the thickness is quite small, that it is arranged parallel to the upstream flow direction, and that the fluid flows with a uniform velocity over such a body, so that this is essentially a flat plate. We would have a plate in a flow field where the streamlines are just parallel to each other and parallel to the plate. Then again, we have a boundary layer which is quite thin for reasonably large Reynolds numbers. And if the plate is at a temperature difference from the fluid, the fluid temperature is changed by the presence of the heated plate only in a thin layer in this thermal boundary layer region. And what we want to do is now to calculate again the connection between the heat which is transferred into the fluid and the temperature differences arising. We will see that for this connection it is of advantage also to calculate the thickness of the boundary layer of the thermal boundary layer, and this is of help by itself, because it's good to know how far does really the heat penetrate into the fluid. So I will draw this situation once more, but now exaggerate the dimension normal to the surface very much so that I can draw more details of how the boundary layers look. So I have the flat plate, and I will only look at one side. This would be, for instance, the flow boundary layer. What we mean by this actually is the following, that if we consider a cross-section and the fluid velocity as it exists in this cross-section, assuming that, as we did here, that the velocity out here is constant at a value V0, so that would also be the case here, then, and if I draw a velocity profile by plotting the velocities V as they exist at various distances from the surface over the distance from the plate, then I would get a profile which looks like this. This means all of the velocity variation occurs within this range delta. Outside of this distance delta, the velocity is uniform and has, as we assumed, the value V0. Now, actually, we calculated already in the lecture on fluid mechanics the thickness of this boundary layer at a distance L from the upstream end of the plate, and we got, again, our calculation was an approximate one to simplify the calculation, and we found the following relation. The square of this boundary layer thickness is equal to, or let me make it approximately equal, to stress that this was an approximate calculation. Maybe good within 10-20%, which in many cases is really good enough for many purposes. 8 times nu, kinematic viscosity of the fluid, times L, the distance from the upstream end, for which I want to know the boundary layer thickness, divided by this approach velocity. V0 is also the velocity with which the flat plate is approached. Now, if I have heat transfer, then I have, as mentioned before, a thermal boundary layer the thickness of which may or may not be equal to the thickness of the flow boundary layer. So to consider a more general case, we will assume that the thermal boundary layer is thinner than the flow boundary layer, it's not equal to the flow boundary layer. I also assume, if I draw it in this way, that the whole length of the plate is heated. So let's say the plate has a temperature T sub W, where the temperature in the fluid is T zero. And again, what the meaning of this border of the thermal boundary layer is that the temperature T zero with which the flow approaches the plate remains the same in all of the flow around here. The temperature changes as a consequence of the heated plate only within this thin thermal boundary layer. This means if I draw now a temperature profile, that the temperature is constant even up to this cross section, delta T, and let's say equal to T zero. So this would be the temperature in the fluid. Now, if the temperature of the wall is this here, T wall, then the temperature within the thermal boundary layer would change from here in some way to the wall temperature. Now we want to calculate. Actually, when we calculated the velocity boundary layer in the previous lecture, the main approximation which we made was that we approximated the actual shape of the velocity profile within the boundary layer by a straight line. So we made the approximation if I draw once more now the approximate velocity profile, let the velocity change linearly and then stayed constant outside of the boundary layer. Again, delta. And in order to calculate now the heat transfer situation, we will make the same simplification for our temperature profile. So our temperature profile then will be approximated in this way, that it is constant up to this point and changes then linearly to the wall temperature T sub W. This here is the temperature T sub zero. May I ask a question? We started somewhat late. Can I go somewhat beyond? Okay. The next step is the first step. Yeah. Now, as always, if we want to calculate in such a flow region the heat transfer, then we start out by making an energy balance on a appropriately selected control volume. And how simple the calculation is depends on how cleverly we select our control volume. What we will do here is the following. We make our control volume in such a way that we consider this plane here, and we assume in our calculation that the plate is infinitely large or very large in the direction normal to the blackboard, so that the flow situation at each cross section is the same as in the blackboard itself. And then I will, the dimension of our control volume normal to the blackboard, we will just select as it being equal to 1, so that we can forget about this dimension. Then we go from here back to the, let's say another cross section would be here at the leading edge. Now, there will be a streamline which goes through this point, and we follow this streamline back. It might have a shape like this. And then we close the control volume by a plane in the surface of the wall. And what we will have now in our energy balance will be the following. We will have a heat, well, In steady state, we don't have to worry about energy storage. Again, we neglect it. We neglect heat sources or heat sinks. If one has those, well, the calculation would be a little bit more complicated, but really not more difficult. If we have no heat sources, steady state, we don't have to worry about heat storage in the interior or any heat generation in the interior. Then all of the energy which is transported into our control volume through some of the control surfaces must be equal to the energy which is transported out of the control volume through the other control surfaces. And we have always two means by which energy can be transported, either by conduction in the fluid, essentially from one fluid layer to another fluid layer, or by convection with the flow of the fluid. And at sufficiently large Reynolds numbers, we find always that through control volume, through which we have flow, the heat transported by convection is very large compared to the heat transported by conduction, so that we can neglect conduction compared to convection. So we have flow through this here, obviously, because we have streamlines going through this control surface. So we have to consider convection into the control volume through this surface. We will have to consider convection out of this control volume through this surface. Since this is a streamline, there is no flow through this control surface, so we have no convection through this control surface. Since this streamline is outside of the thermal boundary layer, the temperatures are uniform across this streamline, so there is also no conduction. So we don't have to consider anything, any transport, energy transport through this streamline. Through this streamline on the plate surface, we have no convection because there is no flow through this streamline, but we will have conduction because here we have a temperature gradient into the fluid. So this is a physical process which we have to consider, and we have to write corresponding terms down. Now, first, in order to calculate the heat transported by convection in and out, one requirement is that we know the mass flow. And we will calculate the mass flow through this. Let's say we call this m dot. Obviously, the mass flow through here must be equal to the mass flow through here, because there is no mass flow across the streamline. So this will be m dot 2. But it is simpler to calculate it here, so we will calculate it through this cross-section. And we can write, so m dot is equal to cross-sectional area. Cross-sectional area is delta T in this direction, and we set 1 in the direction normal to the blackboard, so cross-sectional area is simply delta T. If we multiply the cross-sectional area with the velocity through this cross-sectional area, then we get the volume flow. But now we have to be careful. The velocity is not uniform. The velocity is 0 at this point. The velocity is, well, how large is the velocity at this point? We will first calculate what the velocity at this point is, where it's a distance delta t. And for this purpose, I will introduce the following parameter. I call the ratio of the thermal boundary layer thickness to the velocity boundary layer thickness, zeta. Then I can say the delta T is theta times delta. Now, since this is a triangle, then this velocity must also be zeta times V0. This to this must be equal to V this to this. So here this velocity is zeta to V0. This means at this border I have the velocity zeta V0. Here I have the velocity V0. The average velocity is zeta V0 over 2. It's just half this velocity. So I have to multiply this with zeta times V0 over 2. This gives me my volume flow rate. And if I multiply this with the density of the fluid, I get the mass flow rate. Let me write this in a different form still, which will be more useful later on. The delta T is again theta times delta. So I write this rho times delta times zeta squared times v zero over 2. Okay, and now we can start with our energy balance. Let's call the heat flow per unit time through this cross-sectional area Q exit. It's exiting. And the heat flow through this cross-sectional area Q at the inlet. Then we just mentioned there is no heat flow through this surface of our control volume. There is heat flow by conduction. This can be only by conduction because the velocity is zero at this point here from the wall into the fluid, and I will call this Q sub C, conduction. So my energy balance obviously takes on the form QI into the control volume plus QC into the control volume must be equal to QE out of the control volume. Now, we'll calculate each of these terms. Let's start with the QI, which is quite simple. The mass flow is m dot. If I multiply this with a specific heat, and I mentioned that in case we should have a gas, then we know that we have to use a specific heat at constant pressure. And this gives the heat capacity. If I multiply this with the temperature, then I get the energy content, which is carried through this. And the temperature through this cross-section, because it's again outside of the thermal boundary layer, is T0. Now, the next term, let's take the QE, because this is convection also. The mass flow is again m dot. The specific heat is Cp, same fluid. Now, what is the temperature? Let's see. The temperature here changes again from this value, T0, at the outer border, to the T-wall, at the inner border. So we have to use some average temperature. And actually, the temperature which I use, the arithmetic mean, is not quite the correct value. But it, since we are interested in getting an approximation, we will do this. So the temperature which we want to use is this one here. And we can write this in the following way, T0 plus the difference between wall temperature, T-wall minus T0, divided by 2. Okay, and the QC, this is heat flow by conduction, so we have to use Fourier's equation, minus K times the cross-sectional area, L times 1, times the temperature gradient, the temperature variation per unit length, dT over dy, if I can call y the distance or direction normal to the plate surface. And since I know how the temperature varies, the temperature variation along the length delta T is equal to T-wall minus T0. So the temperature variation per unit length, and it is the same everywhere, because I consider a linear variation, is T-wall minus T0 divided by delta T. And if I write it in this way, then I have already taken care of the minus sign. So I can write K times L times T-wall minus T0 divided by delta T, or let's immediately write for delta T again, zeta times delta. Yeah, and now I have to introduce the terms into this equation. Let's see, I think I can abbreviate it. I have here QI, that is this term. On the other side of the equation, I have this term. You see that the first part is exactly the same as this. So these two terms obviously cancel out on both sides of the equation. So on one side, I have only the QC, KL times T wall minus T zero over zeta delta equal, and on the other side, just the second term remains, is equal to CP M dot. And maybe I can do an additional step. I introduce now for the M dot the term which I have here, times rho times delta times zeta squared times V0 over 2. Now I get into trouble. I have to take this off. Times what is left, T wall minus T0 over 2. Yeah, the CP is here. And I see that I can cancel the temperature difference out. And what I am interested in the moment, as I mentioned, is what is the thickness of the thermal boundary layer, or what is the theta, since I know the thickness of the velocity boundary layer. So we solve this equation for theta by bringing this term over to this side, which gives theta cubed equal 2. And then I will have KL. And then from here I get 4 divided by CP rho times delta squared and V0 divided by V0. Okay, and I can now introduce a delta squared from here. So I get 4 divided by 8 is 1/2 times KL. No, excuse me. Let's see. I have, if I turn around, if I write 1 over delta squared, 1 over 8, I took care of this, times V0 over L, which cancels out against the L over V0. So I have just the K. But then I have the nu, yeah, which is in the denominator, it's okay. So CP rho nu. And this is all, yes. Now, before, we had already, when we talked about conduction, we found that this group quite often occurs. Thermal conductivity divided by specific heat times density. And we had actually introduced a name for it. It's called the thermal diffusivity, and the symbol for it was alpha. So that we can write then for theta cubed equal 1/2 times this whole group is an alpha. Alpha over nu, where maybe we should make a note. The alpha is a combination of properties. Thermal conductivity divided by specific heat and by density. Now, let's look at the equation. One basic requirement for each equation is that the various terms appearing additive or in subtraction in the terms have to be the same, have to have the same dimension. We can only add meters with meters with meters, or meters per second with meters per second, and so on. Now this here is a ratio of two lengths, so it's dimensionless. This must mean the alpha over nu must be dimensionless too. And if you check, you find that this really is a parameter which has no dimension. Since it very frequently occurs in heat transfer calculations, this ratio, or actually the inverse of this ratio, has been given a special name. It is called Prandtl number, nu over alpha. We will see that it is very important that it characterizes many heat transfer situations. The physical meaning of it is something like this. The nu describes the effect of viscosity on the flow field. The alpha describes somehow the thermal situation in the flow field. So it somehow is a ratio, describes somehow the ratio of the effect of one property, nu, on the flow field to the effect of another property on the corresponding thermal field. It is, of course, since both are properties of the material, this is a property too, which has an additional advantage that it has no dimension. And this means we can, for various properties, we can, for various fluids, we can list the Prandtl number. And I will just do, well, let's first calculate from here the theta itself. Now, this what we said, the theta is 1 over 1.26 times the 1 over the cube root of Prandtl number. And again, our calculation was approximate. One approximation was that we made this linear assumption of the temperature variation. Another was that we didn't quite introduce the right mean value for the temperature in here. So if one makes a calculation more exactly, one finds that this factor really drops out. This means more exactly the theta cubed is the theta. This means the ratio of the thermal boundary layer thickness to the velocity boundary layer thickness is just 1 over the cube root of Prandtl number. And maybe with this we should finish for today. So I think this is a relationship which is quite important, which will tell us quite a bit about the heat transfer situation and, of course, the definition of the Prandtl number itself. And the next time then we will see how this now, how with this parameter we can calculate the heat transfer from the surface into the surrounding fluid. In itself this is quite useful because it tells us how far the temperature penetrates into away from such a surface.